He's grown the company from 70 people, 60 times over 2,000 people. It's grown hugely internationally. So why has it been so successful? You took this growing company, but you've been able to make it an international success. How do you take a SaaS business and make it an international success?
Yeah, well, I think the first thing is you've got to have a big market. You know, you're able to take advantage of a big paradigm shift out of there and create the category of digital transaction management, which basically means empowers anyone to transact anything, anytime, anywhere on any device securely. And if you think about who we're disrupting, it's paper. And so now we have 200 million unique users on the DocuSign Global Trust Network, 300,000 companies have straight standardized on DocuSign. Top 15 banks, top insurance companies, pharmaceutical companies, we're putting on 300,000 unique users a day. But I think really the key is the value proposition. In terms of the impact on the bottom and top line, also in terms of improving the customer experience. And the third thing is reduce risk in terms of security and compliance. That's what's really driven the success of DocuSign.
So how have you opened up so many new markets and gone global and entered new markets?
Yeah, so it can be a combination of factors. First of all, obviously we started off in the U.S. And to leverage that strength in the U.S. with global, you know, international companies and subsidiaries, also global partners we have four prong partnership with companies like Microsoft, Google, Salesforce, SAP, Visa, where they are enterprise customers for DocuSign. They are all equity investors. We have a go-to-market with them and integrate our products. So, for example, going over to Germany, Deutsche Telekom is an investor. They host our data center. They resell us. We're a huge customer. So I think partners is obviously a key. The other key thing is to understand it's not one size fits all. When you go to another country, you get one chance to make a first impression. And business is global, but trust is local. So the most important thing is establishing trusted relationships in the country you're entering before you enter.
So before we came up here, we were talking about, I have a 9-month-old daughter, and you have two kids, and you're sending them to a English-Chinese school to learn Mandarin because you believe that that's the future. What are your future plans for going to China?
Well, it's funny you say that because I'll be heading over there in December. I'll be speaking at Fortune's Brain Tech Conference, and that will be the first listening trip in terms of going over to the country of China. It's the last major country that that we entered. We wanted to make sure, because particularly in China, the one thing I do know, you do only get one chance to make a first impression, and we want to go over there and understand the business over there. We've already put on our first DocuSign advisory board member from China, David Powell, who's running this, and establish those relationships in terms of partnerships and understand that. The great thing about what we've done in the technology is that when we entered into Japan, they have the equivalent of the Chinese job they call the Hanko, so they don't necessarily,
Yes.
So we have the, we call it the Docu Chop.
Yes.
And you know, the other big advantage, I think, is that China is the nation of traders. And we're the global standard everywhere else in the world other than China. And I think it, in terms of reducing the friction in terms of trade and helping increase trust around the world, I'm really looking forward to that.
So you talked about when you went to Germany, you found a local partner, they were an investor, they're effectively a distributor and partner for that country. So are you looking for Chinese investors, Chinese partners to enter China in a way?
Absolutely. So we're looking for not only those partners, we in terms of cash position, we're okay, so it's not for the money, but it is being able to strategically integrate our partner strategy with our equity financing strategy along those lines of the four pillars, and to look for those early customers. So for example, before we put anybody on the ground in Germany, we said we are going to have a partnership with SAP, which investor, enterprise-wide, uses everywhere around the globe, they resell us. We also said Deutsche Bank, the biggest bank. We also said Deutsche Telekom, and not until we got those guys' customers would we, and they all are now. And so, you know, it's kind of very top-down driven, particularly in Germany.
So a lot of your success is through ecosystem, and we're fortunate enough to be here in Silicon Valley and have the Silicon Valley ecosystem. Can you replicate that anywhere else in the world? Do you see that? Where do you see that being replicated? And how are you, as a business, helping to replicate that and help commerce around the world?
Yeah, it's funny because I get asked that question anytime I'm outside of Silicon Valley. I was just in London and I was being interviewed. Somebody from the Financial Times, you know, a top reporter from the Financial Times, and he said, you know, can we do Silicon Roundabouts? And I said, look, you've got everything. It's a center of global commerce. You've got great technology, but I'm not so sure because. In Silicon Valley, it's not this financial all this financial money here on Sand Hill Road or the legal infrastructure or even the university. It's the mindset, and I think the best way to understand is maybe through a little story. And the guy who was my mentor for 5 years when I was running Ariba was John Chambers. He just retired from the board or announced his retirement yesterday. And you know when I would meet with him every month for breakfast for those 5 years. And the first time he goes, Keith, you can ask me anything you want at all. You know, questions you can't ask anybody else. So I mean, and I did. About a year into it, I came in into his office and said, Keith, I know what you're thinking. I go, John, what am I thinking? He goes, why am I doing this? As a matter of fact, I was actually thinking about it this morning. And he goes, well, I'll tell you why. You see, when I came out from Boston, I didn't know shit from Shinola. And you see, somebody helped me out. His name is Lou Platt. God rest his soul. He was the CEO of HP. And I asked him, why are you doing this for me? And he said, because somebody did this for me. So Keith, I don't ask anything in return. I just ask that you met that next generation. And he goes, Keith, that is the magic of Silicon Valley. So in terms of being able to duplicate that, pay it forward, that give back, the genealogy of Silicon Valley, like Ariba, we spawned 10 public company CEOs, right? So it's like that genealogy is key. And once you get that flywheel going, it's like a black hole. Even light can't escape it. That's why everybody from around the world, the best, like you, of extraordinary ability, wants to come to Silicon Valley. And I mean, I certainly think that if any place has the opportunity to do that, that's China. That's, I think, what makes everything so exciting.
So on that note, culture is really important. How do you cross that chasm into dealing with the culture with a with a global company, with people in Germany, you have one way of looking at things, one way of interacting, and people in Japan, now people in Japan, people in China, very different cultures. How do you manage a company with thousands of people across the world?
Well, that, I mean, by the way, that diversity in terms of the cultures is the magic, and where the genius comes from. I think it starts off with, you know, the first word is respect. And also, I think, trying to really understand that culture, trying to put yourself in their shoes. You know, that's why I've got those, you know, twins going to the Chinese American school. And by the way, even if you can't speak the language, to know the top 50 phrases in the language is just a great form of courtesy. But there are universal principles that apply regardless of the country. And I think the most important thing is developing trusting relationships that, of course, get built over time. But, you know, at the end of the day, people do business with people they trust. So that is everything.
So if people want to find you, connect with you, how do they do that?
Just send me an email.
What's your email?
It's KeithJProtter@DocuSign.com.
Keith, thank you very much. We're out of time. That is a perfect ending. Thank you so much.
Murray, thank you so much. It's an honor to be here. Thank you.